Chapter 31. Flight and Pursuit. Grand Tutor Wen's army left Zhaogou with flags flying and amidst the clamor of gongs and drums, in pursuit of Huang Feihu. Huang Feihu's party, meanwhile, had passed through Mengjin, crossed the Yellow River, and reached Mianchu County. As Commander Zhang Kui of the local garrison was a fierce fighter, Huang Feihu dared not go through the county seat. He skirted around it and made his way directly to Lingtong Pass. Near the White Oriole Forest, they heard shouts and saw clouds of dust rising in the air behind them. Huang Feihu looked back. He touched his saddle and sighed. Grand Tutor Wen. How can I resist him with this small force? All I can do is wait for my death. He thought. He looked at his youngest son Tianxiang, who was only 7 years old, and moaned inwardly. The boy's so young, yet he'll also meet with disaster. Just then, a general galloped up and told him that an army had appeared on the left. Looking into the distance, Huang Feihu saw Zhang Guifang of the Green Dragon Pass approaching at the head of his troops. Two more reports arrived soon. The four Mo generals had arrived from the Good Dream Pass on the right, and General Zhang Feng had come from Lingtong Pass. Huang Feihu found that he was surrounded on all sides and escape was impossible. He exhaled a sigh so deep that it penetrated far into the heavens above. But now let us turn to the immortal virtue of the pure void. As the immortals were going to break the commandment on killing, lectures in the Jade Emptiness Palace were put off until Jiang Ziya finished creating the gods and life had returned to normal. The immortals were thus idle, spending their leisure time touring the sacred mountains. Today, Virtue of the Pure Void was traveling over Lingtong Pass when he was stopped by the emanation of anger and despair from Huang Feihu. The immortal pushed open the cloud and looked down. So, it's Prince Huang Feihu. If I don't rescue him, nobody will. He ordered his yellow's carved genie. Wrap them up in my universe muddling pennant and hide them in the mountains. I'll see that the soldiers go back to Zhaogou before I send Prince Huang on through the passes. The genie immediately carried out the order. Catching Grand Tutor Wen in hot pursuit, a patrolman from the vanguard rode up. Commander Zhang Guifang of the Green Dragon Pass awaits your orders. When Zhang Guifang came alongside, Grand Tutor Wen asked, Huang Feihu must have fled this way. Have you seen them? No, I haven't. Then, you must go back at once and guard your pass carefully. The Grand Tutor ordered. Before long, a second messenger reported. The Mo generals await your orders, Grand Tutor. Soon the four generals approached. Has Huang Feihu been to the Good Dream Pass? Grand Tutor Wen asked. No, not yet. All right. You'd better return at once and guard the pass lest the rebels get a chance to flee. Grand Tutor Wen then asked Commander Zhang Feng of Lingtong Pass the same question. Zhang gave the same answer and received the same order. As he rode along on his pure black unicorn, the Grand Tutor felt puzzled. Everyone says that Huang Feihu left Zhaogou through the west gate and passed through Mengjin. How can I possibly have missed him? How odd. We came in from all four directions yet none of us has seen him. I must halt my men here and find out the truth. The immortal watching from the air saw that Grand Tutor Wen had stopped. If I don't send him back to Zhaogou, how can Huang Feihu get by the five passes? I must do something else. He decided. He took the lid off his gourd, poured out a handful of magic sand, and threw it toward the southeast. A short time later, patrolmen hurried in. Grand Tutor Huang Feihu is on his way back to Zhaogou. Grand Tutor Wen immediately ordered his army to set off in hasty pursuit. All along the route, he could see a company of armed men rushing swiftly along in front of him. He urged his men on at top speed, but reached Mengjin without being able to catch up with them. When he saw that Grand Tutor Wen had left, Virtue of the Pure Void ordered the genie to bring Huang Feihu and his men back onto the highway. The party rubbed their eyes as if waking from a dream. Looking around, they found that the pursuing soldiers had completely disappeared. the good are certainly blessed by heaven. Huang Ming commented. Brothers, said Huang Feihu, since Grand Tutor Wen's gone, let's make haste to get through Lingtong Pass. Close to the pass, Huang Feihu was stopped by Zhang Feng, who had received the report of his arrival and came out to meet him, leading his troops. Huang Feihu, listen to me. Your father and I are sworn brothers. As an important minister and relative of King Zhou, why do you humiliate your ancestors? Your father's a supreme commander, and you're a prince. How can you turn against your monarch just because of a woman? You're just a rat in my trap. When I heard what you had done, I felt ashamed for you. Take my advice, get down from your beast, and let me take you back to Jiaoga. There must be ministers who will ask for mercy for you. Your whole family may be pardoned from the death penalty. If you don't come to your senses now, it'll be too late for you to regret it. Uncle, Huang Feihu replied politely. You know me well. King Zhou spends all his time lusting and drinking. He listens only to the minions, keeps away from the loyal, and mishandles state affairs. Moreover, he's violated the ethic that governs human relationships. I subdued the East Sea District, performed more than 200 great feats for him, and brought peace and security to the kingdom. How can he now forget all my merits and insult me, yet expect me to remain loyal? I hope that you'll be kind enough to let us through. We would all greatly appreciate your kindness and be sure to return it in the near future. What do you say, uncle? Zhang Feng was furious. You traitor! How dare you try to deceive me with your slander? He raised his cutlass and swung at Huang Feihu, but Huang blocked the blow with his lance. Don't be angry, uncle. Huang pleaded. We're both ministers under the same ruler. If you had been wronged, you would surely take the same action. As the proverb says, subjects may take asylum elsewhere if their ruler doesn't govern properly. It's clearly true. Why be so over-conscientious in my case? Zhang Feng did not relent. You rebellious rogue. How dare you try your cunning tongue on me? He struck again. At this second blow, Huang Feihu lost his temper and urged his divine ox into attack. After 30 rounds of bitter fighting, the aged Zhang Feng was exhausted. He turned his horse and fled. Huang Feihu chased after him. Zhang Feng heard Huang Feihu close behind him. He stealthily hung his cutlass on his saddle and took a small stringed hammer from inside his robes. He swung round suddenly and flung the small, yet deadly, weapon straight at his pursuer. Huang Feihu was an experienced fighter. As fast as lightning, he struck upwards with his sword, cutting the hammer's string and catching the small round hammer in his hand. Zhang Feng was unnerved and fled back to the pass. Huang Feihu did not pursue him further. He ordered his men to place the luggage carts in a circle around their camp and then sat down with his brothers and generals to discuss how to get through. Zhang Feng sat alone in his office at this very same time. I'm old and weak, but Huang Feihu's brave and strong. How can I ever seize him? If he gets through the pass, I'll be guilty and punished. What shall I do now? He wondered and then asked. Where's General Xiao Ying? I await your orders. Huang Feihu's a fearsome opponent. He's not only defeated me, but also taken my stringed hammer. We can't beat him by force. Late tonight, take 3,000 archers and surround his camp. When I beat the bamboo slats, the archers must shoot simultaneously and kill every one of the rebels. We'll cut their heads off and send them to Jiaoga as evidence. Zhang Feng ordered. Xiao Ying received the order and left. But he reasoned with himself. Several years ago, I was under the command of Huang Feihu at Jiaoga. He promoted me to general and posted me here as deputy commander. How can I be so ungrateful as to forget his kindness at such a critical moment and see his whole family massacred? He disguised himself and secretly made his way through the darkness to Huang Feihu's camp. Huang Feihu ordered his patrol to escort him in. Xiao Ying knelt. I used to be under your command. You appointed me here as deputy commander several years ago. Zhang Feng's given me a secret order to surround you with archers and shoot you all late tonight. But to forget the kindness you've shown me would be a crime against heaven, so I've come here to give you a warning." Huang Feihu was shocked by the news. "Many, many thanks for your great virtue. If not for you, every member of the Huang family would meet a cruel end. You've saved our lives, and we'll never forget it. But can you do anything to rescue us from this critical situation, General? Mount your divine ox immediately and fight your way through the pass. I'll open the gates and wait for you there. There should be no delay lest word leak out." Xiao Ying answered. Huang Feihu and his group mounted their steeds and galloped towards the pass roaring ferociously. As it was already dark, the guards at the pass were totally unprepared and had no chance of coping with the emergency. As soon as Xiao Yin opened the gates, Huang Feihu rushed through at once. Zhang Feng was sleeping when he received the report that Huang Feihu had gotten through the pass. "It was my mistake to have trusted the wrong person." Xiao Yin served under Huang Feihu. He reproached himself. He immediately mounted his horse and set off in pursuit. But he never imagined that Xiao Yin was waiting for him in the darkness. As Zhang Feng rode through the gates, Xiao Yin caught him off guard and struck him off his horse. When he was sure that Zhang Feng was dead, Xiao Yin galloped after Huang Feihu. "General Huang, take your time. I've already killed Zhang Feng. I'll go back and block up the pass so that the king's men will be delayed long enough for you to get well out of their reach. I'm sorry that we must part. Who knows when we may meet again. I don't know when I can return the kindness you've shown me today." Huang Feihu thanked him with great sincerity, and they bade farewell to each other. When they reached Tongguan Pass, about 80 li from Lingtong Pass, Huang Feihu's party halted and set up camp. Commander Qin Tong of Tongguan Pass had already learned of his arrival. "Huang Feihu, you fancied that you could hold your princeship for 1,000 years, but you've really come down in the world now," he muttered to himself, smiling sarcastically. He ordered, "Take the soldiers out and confront Huang Feihu." He donned his armor and made ready for battle. "Who's the commander here?" Huang Feihu asked. "Chen Tong." Zhou Ji answered. Huang Feihu was silent for some time and then said with a sigh, "Chen Tong was under my command. Once when he disobeyed my orders, I sentenced him to death, but then pardoned him at the request of other generals. He holds a grudge against me. As commander here, he's sure to seize this opportunity to get revenge. What should we do?" As he pondered over the problem, he heard a great clamor outside. He mounted his ox and rode out of the camp to find Qin Tong flourishing his weapon in a great display of prowess. Qin Tong pointed at Huang Feihu with this halberd. "How do you do, General Huang? You used to enjoy a high position, but why do you flee through the passes today? On Grand Tutor Wen's orders, I've been waiting for you here for a long time. Get down from your beast at once, and I'll take you back to the capital. There's no other choice for you." "You're wrong, General Chen," Huang Feihu replied. "Ups and downs are common in this world. You were once under my command, and I treated you like my own brother. When you were court-martialed, I exempted you from capital punishment at the request of other generals. By insulting me today, could you be trying to get revenge on me? Ride forward then. I'll dismount and surrender at once if you can beat me in 3 rounds of combat." Huang Feihu raised his lance and charged straight at Qin Tong, who flourished his halberd to meet the challenge. They fought desperately back and forth for more than 20 rounds. Qin Tong was far from being a match for Huang Feihu. He pulled his horse out of the fight and began to flee. Huang Feihu yelled angrily, "Get hold of that scoundrel! We can't give him up!" He set off in hot pursuit, but when he was almost on his opponent, Qin stealthily took the halberd in his left hand and threw out his small, light fire dragon javelin. This was a magic javelin from an immortal, which never missed its mark. Huang Feihu was struck beneath the armpit and toppled from his mount with a sharp cry. Seeing him fall, Huang Ming and Zhou Ji rushed out. "Don't you dare to hurt our commander!" they shouted and engaged Qin Tong. As the battle raged, Huang Fei Biao brought his brother back from the battlefield only to find that he was already dead. Huang Ming and Zhou Ji fought Qin Tong with such ferocity that he was forced to flee again. To avenge their commander, Huang Ming and Zhou Ji galloped after him, determined to chop him to mincemeat. Hurling the javelin a second time, Qin Tong brought Zhou Ji down from his horse, but when he circled back to decapitate him, Huang Ming intercepted him. As he had won twice, Qin Tong was unwilling to continue the fight with Huang Ming. He left the battlefield and returned to the pass. When Huang Fei Biao returned with their father's corpse, Huang Feihu's three sons burst into tears. Huang Ming brought Zhou Ji's corpse back to the camp as well, and laid it on the grass. There was not a single man in the camp who was not filled with grief. Having lost two generals, they knew neither where to go nor what to do next. Meanwhile, Virtue of the Pure Void was meditating on his green cloud bed when he felt his heart jump in alarm. He made a divination on his fingers and found out that Huang Feihu had suffered a great calamity. "Tell your fellow disciple to come at once," he ordered White Cloud Lad. Before long, White Cloud Lad brought in a youth who was 9 feet tall and had smooth creamy skin, two bright eyes, and a powerful body. His hair was coiled and he wore a robe tied with a hemp belt and a pair of straw sandals. The youth bowed before the immortal. "You wish to see me, master?" he asked the immortal. "Your father's in trouble. Go and rescue him." "Who's my father, master?" "Your father's Huang Feihu, a prince of the Shang dynasty. He's been killed by a fire dragon javelin at Tongguan Pass. First revive him and then introduce yourself. In the future, you'll serve together in the founding of the Zhou dynasty." "How did I come here?" the youth asked further. 13 years ago, I was riding on a cloud to Mount Kunlun when my path was blocked by a strong beam of light emanating from your skull. I looked down to find you an uncommon child, destined to have a brilliant future. I brought you here as my disciple. Your name's Huang Tianhua. I'm obliged to save your father from this disaster." The immortal gave Huang Tianhua a sword and a flower basket and taught him how to deal with Chen Tong's magic javelins. He cautioned the youth. "You must return as soon as your father gets out of Tongguan Pass. You're not to accompany him to West Qi. You'll meet him again in the future." Huang Tianhua knelt down and kowtowed to his master, and then left the Purple Sun Cave. He picked up a handful of dust, threw it in the air, and traveled swiftly on it to Tongguan Pass. If you want to know what happened to Huang Feihu next, you must read the next chapter.